forevermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory.
Speak to you about from the life of Moses. We started talking about Moses end of last year, and we were talking about the heroes of faith. So I'm just kind of picking up there. Are you still all right with the heroes of faith? You bored with that? Okay. So I just want to pick up from the life of Moses, you know, and we spoke last time, we talked about Moses, how he was born, the circumstances around his birth, and how Pharaoh wanted to kill all the boys, and how his mother took him and put him in a basket, and they let him drift down the river, and eventually Pharaoh's daughter saw him and she picked him up, and how God just saved his life, and where this whole story started about Moses, you know, and it's so important. But what I want to share with you from the life of Moses from here on for maybe a few days is this week and next week, are 7 steps of your call, the 7 steps towards your calling, you know, and from the life of Moses. You know, I think that all of us, the Bible says, all are called, but few are chosen. And I want to try and share that, bring that out and across in this message as well, or over these 2 weeks, where all are called, but few are chosen. So everyone that's sitting here, I believe that we are called. God has got a call for your life, a purpose for your life, a plan for your life. You are not here for nothing. You are here by design, by God's set purpose, by God's set timing. Sometimes I feel that I'm out of time. I should have been in those days where they fought with the swords and they were using these big ships with the sails and whatever, you know. But I love those, that time, you know. But I'm in God's perfect plan and His perfect time for this time, you know. And a girl that we knew sang a song, and there's a scripture in the Bible says that you were born for a time such as this. You know, and we are born, we were born for a time such as this. Whatever is happening now in the world, whatever is happening around us, we were born for this. You know, and when the enemy comes against you, when things come against you, when we look at the things that are happening around us, you were born for this. I remember there was a movie at one point, I can't remember. And the guy also said, we were born for this. They were going into this whole thing. We were born for this, you know. And you must kind of get that attitude that I was born for this. And whatever stage you are, maybe you're a little older like Tani Velma. But it's your time, you know. It's still beautiful. Beautiful. Actually, I Tani gedated. But you know, you were born for this time. Now, whatever stage in life you are, God has got a set purpose for you. You need the wisdom that you need in the age that you are in. For me, I could have been a minister, I could have had big things or whatever at the younger age, but I'm in God's plan. Amen. I had to go through the trucks and I had to go through the things that I went through to be who I am today. And you know, the Bible says all things work together for them that love Him. So whatever the enemy has brought and has planned or tried to disturb or destroy, God will bring it all together for them that love Him. Just keep on loving Him. That's the key. Just keep on loving Him and He will bring it together. Amen. All right, so I just want to, 7 steps towards your call. And I want to start with the first 2 stages of, the first 2 points or stages of your calling. That is all in God's hands. You know, so many times there's things that you can do, there are things that you can do in your own ability, but there are things that is in God's hands. Sometimes God requires from us to do things, to step, like if there's a prophetic word spoken over your life, you need to start working towards that. Believe that word, take that word, and act upon that word. You know, so a prophecy is conditional. It's not always set in stone. If a prophet has spoken over your life and it doesn't happen, you can't turn around and say, he prophesied that and it didn't happen, you know. The prophecy is conditional. There are things that you need to do. There are things that you need to believe. You just need to start praying about that prophecy. You need to start acting upon that prophecy. You must start working towards that prophecy or that thing that God has spoken over your life. You must see it as because it's spoken while it's not there yet. So you must see it spoken and then believe it and start saying, Lord, I will direct my life upon what you've spoken. You know, and then God can start bringing the things into place and add it on and so on. I know a few prophecies in my life and I've shared it with you. And I've always, everything I do, I kind of just bounce it off that prophecy. The Lord said, do not run after other men because you will see the good thing but receive the bad thing. So in my life, I do not run after other men. I could have been much further in my life, but I do not run after many men. Other many will run after the 99, but you will go to the one. So if people judge me, oh, the open ears you do, or this, it doesn't mean anything. God said, do not run after other men. He said, many will run after the 99, but you go to the one. So I will stick to going to the one. And he said, and many shall come and trust under your wings. So there is a promise that many shall come, and many shall trust under your wings, you know. And you guys are part of the many. You are the first few of the many. So the many are still coming. Amen. The word said, God spoke to me, he said, your latter will be greater than the former. We had a former, and this is now the latter. So the latter will be greater than the former. So I'm trusting God for the latter that's going to be greater. So I'm preparing for the greater. I'm praying for the greater. So now from 50, we can go to 100. Our goal this year is to reach 100 people or more. Amen. So that's our goal for this year. That's our goal. We have the space now for the 100. We've got 80 chairs, but I've got 170, so it doesn't matter. We have space for that. All right. So we can go 290. All right. So we have enough chairs for that. But that's where we are, you know. So you need to trust God and act upon the word spoken over your life. I think that's the first thing. But my point number one, you know, is the first two things are in God's hands. You can't do anything. And last week I spoke to you about, or the week before, I can't remember, where I spoke about Moses and how his parents saw that this was a special child. They saw that there was something about this child. You know, and you, as a child, you can do nothing about that. It's in God's hands. And God's light will shine upon your life. God will put something upon you. And I thought about this the other day. I thought to myself, but Lord, maybe not everyone will feel that way. But you know, if you think back for a little bit, there was a time in your life where you realized, even as a child, you felt that you were special. You felt that there was something about you. And maybe other people don't see what is on you because they shouldn't see it. But other people see something on you that no one else sees, you know? And you must realize that. And you must stop taking that to your heart. Lord, I'm special. And you're born for this time. You know. So people saw. The Bible says that his parents saw that this was a special child. And they acted upon what they felt. The other people, their children were killed and so on. The Bible says, and they hid him for as long as they could. You know, and I was talking about that last week. Last time, you know, that you need to hold on to the promise of God as long as you can. You must buy time. I've realized in my life many times with the things of God and walking by faith that we need to buy time because God works in His time. You know, and so many times we want to rush in and God must just do everything, and if it's not now, then it's not God, you know. And sometimes your goal should be to buy time. We bought time to have the drive-in church when we didn't have a building, and then the trailers came. Then we bought time doing that as far as we can. We held on to that thing, the promise that the church is going to grow, until we couldn't be there anymore. And then God opened two doors. We've got a farm to do the vision, and we've got a small holding where we can have church. You know, and so now we're here, and we filled this place. We were buying time being in this place till now. Now God's provided a tent going for 100. And like Renee said, if God has given us a tent for 100, then we will reach 100. Amen. And then when we've reached that capacity, God will provide the next things. That's faith. God will provide the next thing. And we need to trust Him. We need to hold on to His promise. Because our latter will be greater than the former. Amen. So hold on to that promise. Hold on to what God has spoken in your life. And they saw that there was something about Him. So they hold on to Him. They hid Him as far as they could. And the Bible says, and then when they couldn't hid Him anymore, they placed Him in that basket by faith. Put Him in a basket, not knowing where He's going to go. And sometimes you have to release the promise. Say, Lord, I put it in the basket by faith. I don't have ability anymore. I don't have the strength anymore. I don't know what to do from here on. But I put it in the basket. I put it in your hands. She placed it in the river. The river is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And she placed it in the hands of the Holy Spirit. And said, Spirit, you take Him. And you guide Him. And you bringing Him into His destiny and His purpose. And sometimes you just need to put it in the hands of God. And then God will guide the rest. You know, faith is trusting God. And just trust Him. And the Bible says, and Pharaoh's daughter saw Him and she said, fetch me the child. You know, God predestined him. Because there's some places in your life where you don't know where God wants you to go. And then you must trust God to guide you and to take you where He wants you to go. You know, and God's purpose for that child, she didn't know that the purpose was that he would grow up in the house of Pharaoh. She didn't know that the purpose of God was that he was supposed to learn and to get to know Pharaoh, to get to know his son who was there when he came back. You know, God had to place him strategically for his purpose. And she didn't know that. They didn't know what the next step was, but by faith they placed him in the basket. And by faith he drifted. And by faith, Pharaoh's daughter, God started doing. That was in God's hands. Some parts of your vision is in God's hands. Amen? And then he became Pharaoh, known as Pharaoh's daughter's son, says the Bible. My point number two is then you enter the school of life. You enter the school of life. So they saw, God sees, you know, there's something special about you. And then God will take you into the school of life. And Moses entered the school of his life when Pharaoh's daughter took him from the river. It wasn't godly. You know, it wasn't the right place. He didn't step into the massive church and now he's the man of God for the hour, you know, the man of power for the hour. He was taken up in Pharaoh, and Pharaoh is a type and shadow of the world. Egypt's a type and shadow of the world. And I'm not saying everyone goes into the world, but you go into the school of life. Your school of life might be like my children in church, in ministry. In their school, they're going through the school of life. They're learning. We set them up to be in a school, a public school, so they can learn to be strong, to know how to deal with people, how to handle situations, how to handle criticism, how to be able to be strong and deal with the issues of life. And as parents, we coach them through those things. And I'm so proud of them because wherever we go, they can hold their own. You know, they can talk to people, they're confident, and maybe some places not so confident, but that's the school of life. You know, and God will always take you through the school of life. The Bible says, never despise the day of small beginnings. You know, God always starts out with you with baby steps. And that's the part of your school of life. God will take you through the school of life. And Moses' school of life was he grew up in the house of Pharaoh. He grew up as Pharaoh's daughter's son. He grew up in a way where he saw himself as a prince. You know the story, the prince of Egypt. He grew up with a princely stature. He grew up knowing that he was the daughter of Pharaoh's, the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He was not the Pharaoh's son in the place where he should become the next Pharaoh. God placed him in a place where he would not become the next Pharaoh. but where he would grow up as a prince and have a princely stature, have a princely knowledge of seeing things. He grew up in the best of the schools of Egypt. At that time, Egypt was the most prosperous nation in the world. And he grew up in the right place because God prepared him to lead millions of people out of that land. And he had to know the customs and the plans of that land and the ways that they do things for him to understand how to approach the Pharaoh, how to do all these things. So God kind of taught him everything, and at the end he didn't use all those things. He came in there with his staff and he threw it on the ground and he turned into a snake. You know, he did things that were supernatural, all the 10 plagues, supernatural stuff, and they pulled him out. But he knew what their gods were. That's why the 10 plagues defeated each one of their gods. Everything that they believed in was destroyed. So he went through the school of life. All of us have a place where you go through the school of life. And maybe if you look back, God has taught you things. And many times people get stuck in that school of life. You know, there's a time where God wants to take you into the next level, into the next thing. But you must get out of that place of just the school of life. And that kind of brings me to point number three. But I just want to say this first. You know, sometimes God will call you out of a family, like we saw Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God called them from it was generational. From Abraham, it went to Isaac. From Isaac to Jacob. And then Joseph and the 12 tribes, and they continue. But some of God's call is just random. It's not random, but God calls you out of obscurity, where it's a nobody. Nobody knows about this person, and God calls them, like David, the son of Jesse. God calls him out of the blue. First it was Saul, and Saul's bloodline was going to Jonathan, and them all were going to continue that. But then God saw that's not going to work. He needs a different kind of person. And then he calls David. And out of what God sees in his mind, and out of the circumstances, you know, for God, it's not that he doesn't know everything, but we as people have choice. And the earth and the plans of God continually changes because of our decisions. Can you see that? Now, sometimes God's got a purpose and a plan for your life, but you don't make the decision to follow it. Sometimes you make a decision to go into sin rather than to trust the Lord or continue in the things of God, and you delay the purposes of God. And God has to adjust continually to the things that's happening in our lives. But in all that, he has an end time goal. And many people sometimes don't reach that goal because they never lead and follow the instruction. All right? Does it make sense? So we saw So many of it's generational, the call of God, and I believe that's the way God actually wants to do it, because he wants to do a deep work, where he calls you, and then you grow up in that house like, kind of like Moses, but you also saw with Joseph growing up in the house of his father, Isaac, you know, and he grew up, or Jacob, and he grew up in that house, and he became, his father bought him a robe. He wore a robe, he was taught to read and write and all those things, different to his brothers. But he had that character when he came into the house of Potiphar. He carried himself well. And because he carried himself well, and because he could read and write, it opened a door for him. And then when he came into the prison, in a place where he does not belong, he stood out in a place where he didn't belong. And in a place where he didn't belong, he carried himself well. And quickly they saw that this man has got a different spirit. He's a different kind of person. With Joshua and Caleb, the Bible says they had a different spirit. You know, and when everyone said, we can't take this land, we will not be able to do it, he had a different spirit. They had a different spirit. They said, we can do it. Because they were close to Moses. And with Moses, all things were possible. They saw him come down from a mountain. His face was lit with the glory of God. That they had to veil his face. They were with him close to the tent of meeting. And in the tent of meeting, when God came to meet with them, so much that Joshua actually stayed with the tent of meeting where the glory of God was. While Moses left, he stayed in that presence a little longer. You know, so they experienced God. There was a deeper thing that God has done in them. And all of us as Christians in South Africa, we had the opportunity to be in church from an early age. And don't think that's for nothing, because God has been preparing you. And I believe that generational callings is because God has got deeper things in line for you. You know, He wants you to learn about certain things. He wants you to have a deeper understanding. I grew up in the church, a lot of the church things, I've been in and out and all kinds of stuff, you know. But I grew up with the things of God. And therefore today I have a better understanding. I have a better knowledge of the things of God. And maybe I could have been much further or much better, but I made some choices that put me on other tracks, you know. Is this making sense? I'm just speaking from my heart this morning. You know, and so God wants to do a deep work in our lives. That's why God wants to work generationally. But sometimes the generation doesn't listen. Sometimes a child doesn't respond. Sometimes people don't take up their mantle, don't take their calling. And then God has to make a plan and raise up someone else and say, like Saul didn't do what I required of him, wasn't faithful, so now I'm going to raise up a man after my own heart, and He raises up a David. When Elijah said that, Lord, I'm the only prophet left, and this Jezebel, she's going to kill me, what else? And he was afraid, I'm the only one left, and so on and so on. And God said to him, go and anoint the king, and then go and anoint Elisha in your place. God said, I'll raise up someone else to fulfill your calling and your destiny. Elijah didn't defeat Jezebel, but Elisha did. You know, sometimes we do not fulfill that call, or we don't finish that requirement. But still, God used Elisha for a lot of years still, because He was preparing Elijah, because He was preparing Elisha. You know, God is so awesome. He always takes care of us. And even though we fail Him, He still uses us. That's the grace of God. You know, so many times you must realize that God loves you so much. He will not let you go. As long as He can, you are alive, His hand will be on you. He will love you. He will work with you. Even though you fail Him, sometimes the way we grew up or whatever we've experienced, or maybe the faults of our parents, we lose out on some characteristics that God designed for us. But He doesn't, the Bible says that geknapte riet sal hy nie uitwis. He just keeps on using you in preparation of something else to go into that thing. Amen? Okay, so my point number three is the conflict stage. So the first one people see, those were in God's hands. The school of life, that is in God's hands. Because you're not called yet or whatever. It's in God's hands how He works with you, and your decision determines how far God gets with you. But then there comes the conflict stage. Moses was born, he was on the water, he grew up in the house of Pharaoh, he learned all the things of a king, he had a good stature, he carried himself well, but there came a conflict stage in his life where he said he refused to be known as Pharaoh's daughter. And I just want to read to you Hebrews chapter 11, verse 24 to 27. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 24 to 27. He says, by faith Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Powerful. When he grew up, he refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Remember I told you that when Pharaoh's daughter got him from the river, then the little girl went and she called his mother, and she nursed him. And God gave her a chance to install the Hebrew in him, to install the story of them in them, or a chance to be a part of his life. And I believe that many times you would say, I want to go and visit Uncle this one and that one. And then he'll go to his family and he'll speak to them and visit with them, and they'll tell him the stories. I believe through all Moses' life, he was always interested in, who are these Hebrews? Why, where do they come from? So while God was training him for being a prince or having all that, he in himself, I believe there was a hungering and a knowing. Who are these people? I come from these people. Maybe he heard the story that he came from them. I'm just using my own interpretation, you know. Because there was something about Moses that always drew him back to where he came from. You know, and what was it that he was called for? I believe that he heard the prophecy that they will go into slavery for 400 years, and then someone would lead them out. And maybe he wondered, could that be me? You know, I don't know. So, but the Bible says, by faith, Moses. So by faith, first of all, because it's the heroes of faith, we're talking about that. By faith, Moses. So by faith, he believed God. He trusted what he heard. He saw what he heard. And he decided that I'm rather going to believe in this God of the Hebrews, of the Israelites. I'm going to believe in this God. And the Bible says, by faith, Moses, when he grew up, he came to a place of maturity. Each one needs to come to a place of maturity in your life as a Christian. You know, he grew up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He refused. It was like a conflict in his heart, a conflict in his spirit. I am not Pharaoh's daughter. I am a Jew. I am an Israelite. I'm a part of this nation of God. I'm an Israelite. I've heard about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he saw that they were a nomadic family, a nomadic tribe. And the people, they didn't have a home. They were believing in a promise. And maybe he heard all these things. And he knew that they believed in a promise. And by faith, he said, I am not Pharaoh's daughter's son. By faith, he said, I am a part of these people. Not caring about the edict of the king. Listen to what it says. It says, by faith, Moses, when he grew up, refused to be known as Pharaoh's daughter, Pharaoh's daughter's son. You know, he chose to be mistreated. The Bible says, he chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. Can you hear the context of Egypt as the world? He said that he refused to be known as Pharaoh's daughter's son. So he didn't see himself in that worldly place anymore. He didn't see himself in that kingdom anymore. He kind of he came to a place of conflict in his heart. And let me tell you that if you want to be free from the world, you need to come into a place where you are in conflict with the world. You know, so many of us today, we are in the world and we're part of the world and we want the world and we want the kingdom of God. Like Trevor Dollar said, you can't walk with your one foot in the kingdom of God and your other foot in the kingdom of the world, because it affects your walking. You know, you have to choose. Sometimes, and as a child of God, and for you to realize your call and to step into your call, there must come a time of conflict between what God has called you to do, the purposes and the plans of God, and the world. You see, because God has called us to come out of the world and into His kingdom. He called us out of darkness and into light. And there must be a time where there's a conflict in your spirit. I decided very early in my life, I'm not going to be a drinker and a smoker and a fighter. I've been on that road till about standard 5, standard 7. And my dad said, if you ever fight again, then me and you, I'll fight with you, because I broke the guy's teeth and noses and stuff like that. You know, and he said to me, you don't fight. And afterwards, a few years later, he said, no, I just meant for that little time. You should have gone back into fighting. But I stopped it and I said, this is not for me. I want to be a child of God. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to walk in love. I'm going to walk in grace. I'm going to walk in forgiveness, you know. And the thing is that there must come a time of conflict in your life where you are in conflict with the world. That's why the things of the world should irritate you. The things of the world and the ways of the world should disturb you. You should not be loving the world, you know. Because if you love the world, it means that you are separated from God. And there comes a time where you need to sort out the conflict in your heart and say, Lord, I'm not of this world. This world does not owe me. This world does not belong to me. I am a part of the kingdom of God. You know, and step out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You see, it's a conflict stage. And Moses reached that place in his life where he said, I am not the son of Pharaoh's daughter. I am not an Egyptian. I'm not a sinner. I'm not a part of this world. I'm not running after the riches. Like he says, it's a fleeting riches. He says, but Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He chose, the Bible says he chose to rather go with the people of God and be mistreated with the people of God. You see, there come a time where you say, Lord, I am putting my heart in this ministry, especially if you call. I'm putting my heart in the things of God. I'm building my life upon this foundation, upon this rock, and it shall not be shaken because the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. You know, and you say, I'm going to put my life in this thing, and I don't care if I'm mistreated. I don't care if people say things about me. I don't care if people speak bad about me. I have decided to follow. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Praise the Lord. No turning back. Amen. And that's where you need to get to. No turning back. He said he would rather be mistreated with these people than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He knew that that was something. That was just pleasures. You know, when you're young, you want to jol, you want to do things. But when you grow older, you realize, that was stupid. Now I need to focus on life. Now I need to get to where I need to get going, you know, because you need to put the things, childish things behind you. Verse 26, he regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt. He regarded the things of God of greater value than the treasures of Egypt. You see, the conflict in your life must be, Lord, I would rather fulfill your purpose than to just have wealth and blessing and riches. You know, because so many people today are living for wealth and riches and blessing. But he decided, rather than to live for God, rather to have these fleeting moments. Because he was looking ahead to his reward. And here comes that word again in the Amplified. It says he was looking forward to his reward, to recompense. That payback that I was speaking about in the New Year's service. You know, recompense, it's a year of payback. It's a year where God will reward you for the good you do and the good you're doing. But it can also be a year of payback for the things you've done wrong. So this year we will see there's going to be a shift. People that are evil and doing the things of evil, they will receive their reward. And people that are serving God and following God, they will receive their reward. It's a year of recompense. All right? That's my word for this year. So because he was looking ahead to his reward, his recompense, the back payment, he said, I would rather live with these Hebrew people. They are nomads. They're traveling everywhere. They kind of have this nomad life or whatever. But I'll rather live like that than have all the security and all the riches of Egypt. I would rather want to be in the plan of God. So the Bible says, by faith he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered. Because he saw him who is invisible. It's powerful. So he did not fear the king's anger, says the Bible. You see, there comes a time where you do not have to fear the things of the enemy, the things of the world. You do not fear the world anymore. The Bible says he did not fear the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. He had his eyes on Jesus. He fixed his eyes. Paul said, I fix my eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher and the perfecter of my faith. You know, he fixed his eyes. The Bible says in Hebrews 11 verse 6, and without faith it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. And we've been looking at this from Hebrews 11. If you must believe in God, you have faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please Him. See, Moses believed in the things of God more than what he believed in the things of the world. That conflict. You must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that seek Him. Moses came to a place, the rewards with God is going to be so much greater than the rewards with Egypt. You know, and he made that decision. You know that he became a part of the destruction of Egypt. And he became a part of the lifting of Israel. You know, he was a man hanging in the balance, and because of his decision, one nation was lifted and another was defeated. You have the ability to lift and to bring down. The Bible says, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. We are part of a king. We are a kings and priests, and we have the ability to bring the kingdom of Satan down. And like Moses was a part, and he was the turning point. He was the thing which everything hang on. And because of his life, one kingdom was brought down and the other one was lifted. And we are going to see the kingdom of God lifted. Do you believe more in that? Do you see that more? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Do you want to see that? Do you want to see that happen? Do you believe that that's going to happen? You see, that pleases God. If you believe in His kingdom more than what you believe in Egypt or in the world, it pleases God. Amen. You know? It's powerful. It pleases God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. If we do not believe that God is God and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him, we will see no reward. We must believe that He is and that He rewards those who diligently seek Him. Moses stepped, think of that. He stepped out of Egypt and he went into a nation that was slaves. Think of it. But he believed more in the slaves and in this kingdom and in this God of these people than he believed in all the gods of Pharaoh. He believed more in that he took sides with that. Think of that big decision. He rather wanted this. He would rather be mistreated with these people because they were going to be lifted up. He believed that they were going to be greater. He believed that they were going to be lifted up. And he knew that this kingdom cannot stand. It's going to be destroyed. It's going to be defeated. And he decided, he believed in God. And it was counted to him as righteousness, the Bible says about Abraham. You know, so he believed God more. The Bible says, by faith he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. He saw this God. Without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is. He believed that God is true. He believed. And that is the faith of Hebrews 11. The faith believing God. Believing in God. Believing in the purposes of God. Believing the plans of God. Believing the things of God. He believed Him. That He is. And that He is a rewarder of them that seek Him. God will never not reward you. God will always reward them that seek Him. We've decided to plant this church, and now God is still rewarding us because we are seeking Him. Now we're getting a tent and we're going to for the next step. You know, but it's growing. It's going to increase. There's no boundaries to the increase of His kingdom. Amen. His kingdom will know no end, and His glory shall know no bounds. In Proverbs 3, verse 5 to 6, and I want to finish. I think if I'm going to finish with that. He says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. You see, he believed in God. He trusted in the Lord. He looked at the lesser, trusting more in the lesser than what he believed in the greater or the bigger. He said, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. To everyone else, it didn't make sense. How can you do this? How can you want to go into ministry? How can you want to follow the things of God? How do you want to be a Christian? You know, there's so much in the world. You can do this, you can do this. How do you want to do this? Nobody loves the Christians. Nobody wants to be Christians. Everyone hates the Christians. If they come against all these things that are in the world today, against homosexuality and against all these kinds of things, then nobody loves them. Why do you want to do this? But the Bible says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. In all your ways, just acknowledge Him. In everything Moses did, he said, Lord, I trust You. I put my faith in You. Amen? And eventually he saw, he was rewarded because he diligently sought Him. Next week we're going to continue with the next three phases of ministry. But of your calling. But remember that. Today I want to finish with this. I want to end with this. There must come a time where there's conflict in your spirit. And Moses had conflict with who he really was. See, there's something inside of you that knows that there is a God. There's something inside of you that knows that He is alive. There's something inside of you. Nature and everything speaks of His goodness. There's something inside of you that just knows. And today we are living in a world where the enemy wants to make you think that it's a lie. Even in my own life, the enemy wants to make me think, why am I doing this? Sometimes when it's tough, why am I doing this? Why am I here? Why am I holding on to this? Nobody wants it anyway. You know? But I must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. You know, and there's something inside of you that knows that He is. And you must trust Him. You must have faith in Him. Do not lean on your own understanding, though sometimes it doesn't make sense. Do not lean on your own understanding. I didn't know how we were going to go for 100. I didn't know this year how we're going to expand, how we're going to make it bigger. I've got a lot of plans in my own way. But God came up with the perfect plan for now. You know, the perfect plan for this season. So trust in the Lord. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, just acknowledge Him. Lord, I bring You into this way, into this thinking, into what I want to do. In my heart, I purposed, I planned, I'm going to do this. But Lord, You're welcome to guide my steps, because Your word says the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. So Lord, You're welcome to order my steps any way You want to. I acknowledge You in all my ways. In all Your ways, acknowledge Him. Just bring Him into that. Make Him a part of it. Acknowledge Him as God. He says, You are God. You are faithful. You are the answer. In all my ways, maybe it doesn't make sense. Maybe it doesn't make sense now, but I'm going to trust You with all of my heart. I'm not going to lean on my own understanding. I'm going to acknowledge You, Lord, and You will direct my paths. And God will always direct your paths if you trust Him. Faith is seeing those things that are not as though they are. Abraham believed God and was credited to him as righteousness. It made him righteous, and it brought so much blessings into his life. The blessing was righteousness. Believe that you are the righteousness of God. Believe that He loves you. Believe that He's going to reward you for diligently seeking. What's the key? Diligently seeking. When we stand here like this morning and we worship Him, you diligently seek Him. When you pray, you diligently seek Him. In all your ways, you just acknowledge Him. Make Him a part of everything. And He will direct your paths. You will always have a better outcome than you expected. Amen?
Amen.
It's powerful. I just want to read to you quickly. Just what we read in the offering. 2 Corinthians 9 verse 8. And God is able to make all grace, every favor and earthly blessing come to you in abundance, so that you may always and under all circumstances and whatever the need be, self-sufficient, possessing enough to require no aid or support, and furnished in abundance. In other words, you will have abundance, furnished. It's like furniture in your house. You will have enough furniture. You will be furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. I want to get to that point. Father, where I have enough so that I can do whatever you want me to do. And it's going to come. When you're faithful, you will be rewarded. Amen. Let's just pray. Father, we just come to you this morning, Father. And Father, right now in this atmosphere, in your presence, Father, in the presence of your Spirit and your spoken word, Father, where your word is sharper than any double-edged sword, it penetrates dividing soul and spirit and joint and marrow, Father. Father, we thank you that in the presence of your word this morning, Father, that has been spoken, light is brought. Father, in the presence where your word is spoken, revelation is brought forth. And Father, today we will acknowledge you in all our ways. And we know that you will direct our paths. You will reward those who diligently seek you. And Father, we thank you that we can come to that place in our lives, Father. And today, that we will draw the line. That we will be like a Moses where there's conflict in our hearts, Father, concerning the world and your kingdom. That we will make up our minds, that we will draw the line in the sand and say, till here and no further. We will make up our minds and say, we're going to live for the kingdom of God, and we are going to give up the kingdom of darkness. And Father, I thank you that you will reward us, that we can have faith in you. Our outcome will be better in the end. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen.